Undersea cables are the unheralded backbones of our global communications network. They cover the globe, carrying gigabits of information within them. So much of our hyper-connected, seemingly ultra-high-tech world depends on these low-tech cables, and they snake their way through a dangerous neighborhood. In this video, we explore the hazardous life of the subsea cable. Just leaving an unexposed copper cable in the bottom of the harsh sea seems unwise. The first underwater experiments happened in 1811. The German polymath Samuel Thomas von Sommering was building the first telegraph network in Bavaria. Sommering's cable had to cross a river, so he wrapped it in rubber to keep it dry. Sadly, this failed because rubber is a water-absorbent vegetable protein. Water got to the copper. A few years later, in 1838, an Irish physician and telegraph pioneer named Dr. William Brooke O'Shaughnessy pioneered a new method of preventing water leakage. This involved wrapping the wire in a palm material called rattan, and then wrapping it again with tar-covered yarn. This successfully sealed the cable and protected it from river water. But an ocean? It is 1845. A pair of brothers, the Brett brothers, proposed to lay down a telegraph cable from Dover in England to Calais in France. They wrapped the half-inch-thick telegraph cable in gutta-percha, an inert organic plastic sourced from Malaysia, and in 1850 laid it down from a paddle boat probably named the Goliath. I think there is some dispute over the boat's name. As you might expect, the cable did not perform super well 54 meters under the sea. It was unprotected and weighed down with nothing more than a few lead bricks. They tried it, and it just carried a few badly distorted telegraph signals before failing the next morning, apparently cut by a French fisherman. For their next try, a railway engineer named Thomas Russell Crampton devised a new scheme. He wrapped the cable in steel wire and deployed it in 1851. It went on to perform quite well over the next few years. Virtually every submarine cable ever since has generally followed this model. At the core, one or several copper wires, which are then wrapped in gutta-percha insulation. The first transatlantic telegraph cable was laid down in 1866, and all 2,500 miles of it had three layers of gutta-percha wrapped around it. Over 300 tons of gutta-percha, what a funny word, were used in total. Gutta-percha was eventually replaced by the plastic polyethylene in the 1940s. And then around the core, we have a cushioning layer, followed by the armoring steel wires that Crampton first came up with. To dissuade bacteria in tropical waters from eating the gutta-percha, cable makers sometimes slathered on powdered silica or brass tape. As communications technologies changed over the years, so did the cables carrying them. Telegraph cables gave way to telephone cables. Adding repeaters in the 1940s boosted the signals and improved the quality of their data. Then, in the 1980s, we had the introduction of optic fiber, which vastly upscaled the amount of data bandwidth that these cables carried. I covered this in a prior video. Tweaks to the design were introduced to accommodate these new changes and differing environments. A number of cable variants exist in the industry, but the main setup is still the same. On one end, you have lightweight cables, the workhorse of the industry. These only have the steel wires wound around them, along with some polyethylene. These are more suited for shallow waters that you know to be safe and stable. From there, you start adding on more layers of protection. Lightweight protective cables will add some more polyethylene and steel tape layers, mostly to combat animals and chafing. Single armored cables will be a lightweight cable with a single layer of steel wire and polyethylene wrapping around it, giving it that extra oomph when the risks of cable cutting are greater. And then there are double armored cables, two armoring layers of galvanized steel wires winding around the exterior of your standard lightweight cable. It's like the 4x4 burger at In-N-Out. You deploy this beefy guy out in shallow waters with high traffic, and when you cannot bury the cable. Undersea cables are often laid out of a boat. The boat carries about several thousand tons of cable inside what is called a cable tank. When it is time, the cable goes out of the top of the cable tank and travels through a path of rollers called a cable highway to the linear cable engine. The linear cable engine does the actual laying or retrieval of the cable. They vary depending on the manufacturer, but seems like the most common designs use sets of tires to handle the cable. The cable is subject to intense tensions during this process, so the ship operators check its quality to make sure that nothing is broken. On occasion, they might power up the cable to test its integrity. If the cables are long enough, then every 60 to 80 kilometers, we will have to add a repeater station in order to amplify the signal and restore its shape. And sometimes you need to attach a piece of cable to the rest of another cable, a process known as jointing. This delicate process involves preparing the ends of the cable, splicing it to the new cable, and then re-encapsulating it in polyethylene and armor to 90% of its original strength. This is exactly as hard as you might think. Subsea cables are subject to a variety of natural, animal, and human hazards. A substantial long-term natural hazard is chafing and corrosion. Currents and waves can chafe the cable's outsides by rubbing it against rocks and gravel. This removes the cable's outside protective layers, exposing its insides to the ocean. Corrosion is a similar situation, except one often induced by biological creatures. In shallower waters, barnacles or shells or sponges can end up covering the cable all over, fouling it up. In deeper waters, the same with kelps and corals. If the area is particularly good for coral growth, the whole thing might end up encased in coral. If a landslide happens underwater where we cannot see it, does it happen? Sure does if you have an undersea cable. During a landslide, you have what are called turbidity currents, fast-moving and dense currents of water and stuff rushing at 45 miles an hour like an avalanche. They can easily cut anything in their way. Landslides have been plaguing cables since the 1880s. Cable repairing ships often noted instances of broken cables buried in fresh piles of sediment or gravel, but scientists did not necessarily connect these to underwater landslides. Then in 1929, a classic case consideration in cable conduct. The Grand Banks earthquake of 1929 was a 7.2 earthquake off the coast of Canada. An hour later, a massive underwater landslide triggered the movement over 175 cubic kilometers of sand and sediment, cutting 11 cables. It is now cited as the textbook example of underwater landslide hazards. Another notable incident was a pair of 2006 earthquakes, magnitude 7, occurring off the southwest coast of Taiwan. It triggered several landslides that broke multiple cables. Losing these cables not only affected communications in Taiwan, but also in Southeast Asia, since many go through the island. Landslides are a particularly big deal in delta areas, where freshwater rivers meet the sea. Rivers, especially after big typhoons, dump large amounts of silt, biological material, and dirt into the ocean. That stuff piles up into big bunches of loosely consolidated materials called slumps. When the slumps move, they break things in their way. And of course, the earthquakes themselves can take down the cables too. Seismic movements can cause the seafloor to slide and reposition, which can break any cables traversing the moving seafloor. The aforementioned Grand Banks earthquake cut 12 cables by itself. Animals can break cables too, often whales or sharks. Whales swim deep to the ocean floor in search of food, and they have gotten entangled in the cables. We're not entirely sure what happens with these incidents, it's not like we can exactly ask the whale, but the theory is that the whale cruises along the ocean floor with its mouth open. Its lower jaw gets caught up in a loose cable, and the whale struggles to get out of this loop but only gets itself more caught up in the mess. The trapped whale cannot go back to the surface and thus drowns. Sad. Another famous culprit, though rare nowadays, are sharks biting the cables. Biologists are not exactly sure what attracts the sharks to the cables, but proper reinforcement solves the problem. Two-thirds of all cable breaks in depths under 200 meters happen because of humans, ship anchors, and fishermen nets. When a boat drops or retrieves their anchor, it drags. If the anchor hits the cable and slides along it, it can cut the exterior armor and its interior core. There are also nets, of which there are two types. Otter trawl nets are big cone-shaped nets that the boat tows through the water for catching bottom fish. There are a pair of one-ton hardwood boards reinforced with steel called otter boards, and their job is to keep the net's mouth open. The boards can snag an unburied cable and damage it. The second major cause of damage is the beam trawl. It's a cone-shaped body with a bag at the end. It's some 10 meters wide and weighs about 4 to 5 tons. The beam trawl has these sliders or shoes on the bottom that scrape across the ocean floor as the fishing boat goes along. If the cable is exposed, then the shoe can cut the cable. In 2009, they changed the shoes to a wing gear that floats over the seabed, though people noted that while this did not cut the cable entirely, it still sliced its insulation, exposing it to the elements. Per the 1884 Cable Convention, the most widely known international law on cables, if a fisherman's anchors or nets gets caught in a cable, then they are obliged to sacrifice that equipment and report the incident to the cable's owner. In return, the convention says that the fishermen are entitled to an indemnity for their sacrificed equipment, though it is not entirely clear how that indemnity is to be claimed. Fishermen anchors and their nets are why undersea cable operators dig trenches for their cables or give them double armor if those cables are in waters less than 1,500 meters deep. Anything beyond that, the anchor hazard is no longer as significant. The waters are too deep, so cable operators tend to just leave their cables out there, laying on the ocean floor. While the vast majority of cable breaks are due to ordinary fishermen and shipping hazards, intentional cable cuts do happen. Many of these are thefts for financial gain. One of the most memorable incidents happened in March 2007 when two vessels, one of which from Vietnam, removed 79 and 98 kilometers of cable from two Southeast Asian networks to sell the copper. Vietnam's internet was damaged for 3 months. It has also happened in Jamaica, Indonesia, Egypt, and more. Most cables within a country's exclusive economic zone, 200 miles within their shore, are relatively okay, but outside of that, the laws get much murkier. The perpetrators might get punished with low fines, or if at all. And then there is the issue of cable cuts as a measure of asymmetrical warfare. Since they can interrupt communications for extended periods of time, cable cutting or control strategies are a critical focus of war planning. For instance, British control of the subsea cable network cut off the Central Powers of World War I from their overseas possessions, and it also forced the Axis powers of World War II to communicate via encrypted radio, opening the door to interception and decryption. And today, of course, we have reports of cable cuts in the Red Sea with resulting effects on internet speed. Considering how easy it can be to cut a subsea cable, simple as dropping an anchor and dragging it across the seafloor, as well as the cost to repair the cable, an attack like that is great for asymmetrical warfare. Easy to do, and easy to deny deliberate intent. The best way to protect a cable is to dig a deep trench, put the cable in there, and cover it. This is challenging because you cannot use excavation equipment underwater. Thus, the primary way we do this nowadays is through the use of high-pressure water jets or underwater trenching machines that look like something out of a movie. Seriously, they do. Just look at them. How deep we bury the cable depends on the conditions. The general rule of thumb is no more than 2 meters, but if the seabed is particularly soft, then an anchor can still damage the cable. So we need to go deeper, but how deep? In the late 1990s, fiber optic operators created this, quote, burial protection index, end quote, to gauge how deep to bury these cables. Once used for thousands of miles of cable, it is now considered outdated. It is up to the integrator's own risk assessment now. If the ground is too hard to cut through, there are alternatives. The most common is called riprap, or just rocks, rock armor, most frequently used to protect beaches from erosion. We first lay down smaller rocks on top of the cable, and then larger rocks after that. Riprap works best in areas where the water currents are calm, leaving the rocks undisturbed. Other things include cover plates or casing pipes, shells that we can encase the cable inside. And if necessary, we can then layer on additional protections like riprap accordingly. I started this video because I have heard about recent attacks on cable internet structure running through certain dangerous choke points, and was looking to see what had been publicly published on how we protect those cables. While the engineering for protecting these cables from natural hazards is quite good, to me it seems that a determined attacker can still cut a cable with ease. So for the most part, we rely on security through obscuration, depth, and the protections we might get from trenches, riprap, and etc. And I'm not sure how that makes me feel. Despite the growth of services like SpaceX's Starlink, undersea cables still carry the majority of the world's internet and telephone traffic. Protecting them is critical. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.